for the 2A championship game coming up here in a few minutes. And Bill, we are really going to see a game where we're going to have two teams more or less looking in the mirror at each other.
Absolutely. You got two teams that play great defense. They play enough offense to win the football game. And I think this is the way football should be played. Jim, you've got one team that has seven players going both ways and only 23 people on a roster. This is the way it was intended to be.
Central A&M against Hampshire, and really, Bill, it ought to come down to really who's going to make a mistake at an inopportune time.
Well, I think the big thing could be the kicking game. As you well know, the wind on this field plays a big part. And if you could play good defense and play for that one break, that could make the difference in a football game.
The teams are just starting their warm-ups here at Hancock Stadium. We will have the opening kickoff coming up in just a bit. Welcome back to Hancock Stadium. We are getting ready for the 2A championship game today between Hampshire and Central A&M. Jim Blaney along with Bill Gorley, and we'll expand a little bit on what we talked about a minute ago about these being two mirror teams. I think what fans are going to be most impressed about of these two teams, Bill, is the way they play defense.
Well, absolutely. They came here, they're both 13-0. They've gone through the wars, and here we are today on a beautiful day to play football, but the defense is going to make the difference. There's no question about it, and I look for a definite defensive struggle.
And if you're talking about defense for Hampshire, you have to start with David McCarthy, their leading tackler, a linebacker, and really all the linebackers are very active in getting the play, but this guy is, as I mentioned, the leading tackler on the team. He's the one who's the leader.
David McCarthy is, as you mentioned, is the leader, but they've only had 7 points scored in the third quarter and 13 in the first half. That's amazing.
Offensively for Hampshire, they've got the thing that we talked about in this game that you'll see a lot of, that is running and a lot of it. And Steve Thompson really the guy to keep an eye on for the Hampshire offense.
Well, they're not real big. Steve Thompson and the two linebackers are great, and then you've got Mark Helm, who's a decent quarterback. But you've got to watch the offense and defense because the defensive people are going to take over.
Let's talk a little bit more about Mark Helm, the quarterback for Central A&M. He'll be wearing number 3 today. And in a running offense, granted, the quarterback, you don't look for them to carry the load, but they're the trigger guy, and they really have to have a good game, even if you're not going to be throwing the football a lot.
Well, he's the guy that's going to make everything go, and he's the guy that has to look at the defense to make sure that he can run the kind of game that the coach wants. And then, of course, you've got a tailback in Tillman.
Yeah, Luke Tillman, what a great year this guy has had. This will certainly be the guy that Mark Helm is looking for when he goes to hand off the football. And at this point of the time, you don't change anything up, Bill. This guy has brought you this far. You got to stick with him.
Well, when you've got 2,000 yards, you're obviously not going to change anything. And the coach coming into the game, he was concerned because Hampshire plays defense so well. But you know he's not going to throw the football. He came here because he's a running coach, and they're going to try and make it go that way.
You know, it's odd how that in football, the passing offenses are so fancy and garner a lot of attention. But when the winds turn cold in November and you start playing for state titles, you usually end up with two teams that play good defense and run the football very well. And that's exactly what we have coming up in the Class 2A title game. Bill and I will be back with the start of this game in just a little bit. Stick around. We'll crown another state champion coming up. Let's go down on the field now and get a report.
Yeah, you're talking about defense here and the linebackers for Hampshire, but you're missing out one big guy that's got something to prove today, and that's going to be Andy Olson. He's the biggest player on the team, 6'3", 260 pounds. He gained 30 pounds in the offseason, and he's not being recruited yet. He's the guy that could be the big difference in the inside of the interior because he is the biggest man on the field today. When you're talking about somebody leading some offense, Helm last week sprained his left wrist. He is okay. The coaching staff told me beforehand that he's going to be able to go. Last year, he broke his left wrist, missed two games, came back and played 3 games on defense with a cast. So he's a tough kid. He came back, led him to the state playoffs last year with a bad wrist. He's going to be back. Also, another man from Moweaqua, also who's going to be a key today, who last year was another angry man. He got a 32 on his ACT, and he's very, very disappointed about that, is Luke Tillman. Tillman does a lot of inside rushing, even though he's not a real big guy. Watch for Tillman to be slicing through the linebackers and darting through the holes. For a look on the road and see how Hampshire got here, Hampshire has been in tight games throughout the playoffs. Byron, just a 9-point game against Aurora Central Catholic. They came back, won that game in the last 40 seconds against Paxton Buckley Loda in the semifinal. They held on with a 3rd down conversion, fumble on the goal line. And let's go over to Moweaqua. Moweaqua has rolled over a few opponents, 51-6 Casey Westfield. beat Carlisle 31-16. And Sullivan, their toughest game to date, 8-2. Big offensive splurge against Lewiston. You can see that they can move the ball. It's up to Helm. If Tillman can move the ball on the ground, mix up that running and passing game, this could be a little more offensive than you think. Let's go back up to the booth to Jim and Bill.
All right, thanks a lot, Dave. And, you know, we talked about how these are two defensive teams, Bill, and how there may not be a lot of points in this game. But I think, in a way, we've almost undersold the offenses. And as people saw from the scores that these teams have rung up during the playoffs, they can get it done on offense, and they can roll it up if they can find something to exploit in your defense.
Well, Central, I think, is probably more offensive than what Hampshire has been. Hampshire has actually had a little difficulty in the playoffs trying to score. But then you have to look at who they played. They played some state championships teams, and they played Aurora Central Catholic, which is always a tough football team. So they have gone the long road to play, and their offense has not come to the front as opposed to their defense.
All right, we're just about ready to get the starting lineups for today's game. Let's go to the PA announcer and the introduction of the players.
The contestants for today's 2A state championship game are the remaining two from a field of 32, which began the playoff series the weekend of October 27 and 28. Central A&M, coached by Mark Ramsey, brings a 13-0 record into this game, while Hampshire, coached by Dan Cavanaugh, also has a 13-0 record. Introducing this afternoon's starting lineups featuring this game between Central A&M and Hampshire. First, introducing the starting defensive lineup for Central A&M. The head coach, Mark Ramsey. At left end, number 54, Brian Huebner. At left tackle, number 55, Sean Prasoon. At right tackle, number 74, Jim Dial. At right end, number 52, Craig Mitchell. At linebacker, number 46, Perry Jordan. At linebacker, number 42, John Brooks. At linebacker, number 35, Joe Paradis. At defensive back, number 3, Mark Helm. At defensive back, number 15, Wes Temples. At defensive back, number 24, Drew Moore. And at safety, number 21, Luke Tillman. Those are the Raiders of Central A&M High School.
You saw listed under the players' names, offensive position, even though it was the defensive starters. There's a very good reason for that. This is football the old-fashioned way. Most of these kids, if not all of them, play both ways, offense and defense. You'll be seeing a lot of them on both sides of the football.
At left end, number 22, Paul Weklinski. At left tackle, number 73, Jeremy Schombach. At left guard, number 58, David McCarthy. At center, number 66, Brian Berry. And right guard, 55, Jason Ormond. At right tackle, number 54, Andy Olson. At right end, number 23, Steve Thompson. At quarterback, number 8, Nick Terry. At halfback, number 14, Bill Seiler. At halfback, number 24, Andy Brock. And at fullback, number 46, Mike Meyer. Those are the Whippers of Hampshire High School.
Once again, you'll be seeing a lot of those guys going both ways, Bill. And this is—it's kind—it's a fun way to play football. And as you mentioned to me during the course of the morning, this is the way it ought to be.
Well, and that, for a coach, it makes it easy when you practice. You just say, "Okay, guys, let's turn the ball over. And now we're going to play defense." Hampshire has seven players that go both ways, and Central A&M has four players going both ways. So, you know, it's interesting. You don't have specialists. If you're a punter, you kick off and you do everything that coincides with that part of the responsibility. This is fun. I mean, we're talking about a team here at Hampshire. They've got 23 players, 19 are seniors, and seven kids play both ways. To me, that's the way the game should be played.
And for those of you who are experienced in watching state championship football here at Hancock Stadium, you notice something odd. It's beautiful, 40 degrees, it's sunny, a little chilly, but it's not bad compared to what it's been in some other years. The field is bone dry. It's just perfect conditions for football here late in November. Paul Kindle will be our referee for today's game. And you see the rest of his crew, as the indication is that Hampshire will receive the kickoff to open up this game. So Hampshire, really, Bill, it's almost a disadvantage in a game where you have two great defenses, that if you have to play offense first, because it really becomes a battle of field position.
Yeah, well, and I would think, with the mentality that Hampshire has, that they would rather have started the game on defense.
Mark Helm will kick off, and we'll get this out of the way right now. One of us will call in Matt Helm before the day is out, I'm sure.
6 degrees.
And the Hampshire Whippers ready to receive the opening kick as they will get the first crack on offense. Our 2A championship game is underway. Helm's kick is a short one. It'll be hauled down at about the 25-yard line. Hampshire trying to set up the return and bringing the ball out to about the 36-yard line is Bill Seiler. An 11-yard return. He was taken down by the kicker, Mark Helm. And you will see Mark Helm do just about everything. Let's take a look at the offense for Hampshire and the way they line up. Of course, the trigger man is number 8, their quarterback, Nick Terry. And the one to keep an eye on, Bill Seiler, who you saw to return the kick, and Mike Meyer, 17 touchdowns during the course of this season. And the offensive lineman, if you're running the football, you better have some horses up front to get the job done. First and 10 from the 36-yard line. Handoff will go to Seiler. He's cut down at the line of scrimmage. And one play in, we've seen exactly what we expected. Luke Tillman coming up to make the stop. Let's quickly set the Central A&M defense for you. And once again, you'll be seeing a lot of these players on the offensive side of the ball as well. Second down and 8. Handoff goes to the first man through, maybe a pickup of 2 yards. Brian Huebner in on the initial stop. And as promised, here's a look at the defense for Central A&M. Brian Huebner, you saw him make the tackle on that last play. And now look at the linebackers and defensive backs starting in today's game for the Raiders. Joe Parody and Mark Helm and Luke Tillman, the safety number 21. He's also the horse in the offensive backfield. Third down, 6. First series of the game for Nick Terry. Has his man open, finds Seiler at the 47-yard line. He'll lunge forward for about 4 more yards before he's hauled down by Perry Jordan and Luke Tillman.
Well, here's a replay, and you'll see Nick Terry drop back. It's a 5-step drop. and he's just throwing to the curl man on the inside, and Perry Jordan comes in to make the stop.
So we mentioned the battle of field position, and a first down on your first series, if you have to receive a kick in a game such as this, very important for Hampshire. They've now got it in the Central A&M side of the field. Handoff goes to the first man through, that's Mike Meyer. He maybe got a yard, brought down by Jim Dial and Perry Jordan.
And Mike Meyer, Jim, he's had 17 touchdowns, and he's averaging about 4.6. And he's a tough inside runner. But the young man that you have to watch is number 14, who's a defensive tackle, Bill Seiler. And we'll talk about him later.
Mike Meyer, I saw him on the movie in the hotel this morning, Wayne World 2. Second down and 9, Seiler on the counter play, picks up some big yards, and he's into the open field. Can't get around the corner, that allows Central A&M to get some people to help out, but not before Seiler takes the ball down to the 27-yard line. 21-yard gain in the play. Luke Tillman got there first, and the corner did a great job, Bill, of at least holding up Seiler until some help could come.
Well, this is coming inside, and of course, you're getting the action going away, and he turns up inside on a little trap, and then he goes to the outside. And as we mentioned earlier, he's an unusual young man. How many people do you know can run the football and have the mentality to be a down defensive tackle at 170 pounds?
Well, the kind of guy who's used to getting up every morning and working on the farm, which is what Bill Seiler is. First and 10, handoff goes to Meyer, and he'll pick up a few yards. Brought down by number 54, Brian Huebner and John Brooks.
Well, it looks like you're looking at an offense right now, Jim. They're going with wide outs. They're trying to split Central A&M out, and then they're coming up on the inside. And it's a very deceptive offense because you've got two wings, and you really have a tailback, but they're coming in and out, and you've got four to five people that can run the football for Hampshire's offense.
Andy Brock and Seiler are the wings. There is one wide man in this formation. Handoff will go to Brock. He gets nothing. He was met as he turned the corner at the 23-yard line by Perry Jordan and Brian Huebner.
There's Nick Terry, and he's just a straight-ahead handoff. Steps out to the outside and then tries to come back inside. And he's brought down by Perry Jordan, the inside linebacker.
Brings up a third and 3 from the 23. Terry Keats goes for Meyer. He makes a spectacular catch. That ball is over his head. He had no chance of catching it, but somehow he pulled it in and goes out of bounds at the 9. First down, Hampshire inside the 10-yard line.
Let's take a look at this replay, Jim, because this is an outstanding play for a team that doesn't really throw the ball that much. Mike Meyer goes high for the ball, tips it with one hand,
and then
comes back down with the ball. That's just outstanding. To be able to keep your balance and keep your poise to be able to make a catch like that.
That thing was airmailed. And Meyer helped out his quarterback, first and goal from the 9. Handoff goes to Seiler. He maybe picked up a couple of yards, brought down by Luke Tillman.
You know, a lot of people would say, well, this is a double wing formation, and it is a double wing set, but they run it out of a tailback, and they have a bevy of backs. They have Mike Meyer, Adam McCarthy, Andy Brock, Bill Seiler, Matt Bean, and they all have them going in motion. So it gives you the idea that you're going one side, and sometimes you're coming back, and you can hurt people on the back side.
This drive has now chewed up 4.5 minutes. Second down and goal. Terry with the pitch to Seiler. He's got blocking out in front, but coming up to fill the gap, Luke Tillman. And then he got a little help from John Brooks.
Here's a little action with the motion man. He's got a little bit ahead, and Seiler's looking for that block from Meyer to cut up inside, and it wasn't there. This is a classic drive, and this is the kind of football that Hampshire wants to play. Keep the ball away from your opponent, play good, tough defense, run the clock down.
11th play of the drive. Ball is on the 6, so third and goal. Terry goes back to pass the screen. It was set up perfectly. Hampshire leads it 6-0. Touchdown for Matt Bean.
Jim, that was a well-thought-out offensive play, offensive set. In fact, if I didn't know better, I would say it might have been scripted because it looks like they just took it one play at a time. Here's what they wanted to do. And a lot of coaches today will script the first 10, 15 plays. I'm not sure that Coach Kavanaugh did that, but it was sure a classic offensive thrust.
Paul Wachlinski in to attempt the extra point. And that one was blocked at the line of scrimmage. It never got that far off the ground anyway. The kick is no good. 6-0, Hampshire has the lead. Central A&M will get their first crack at offense when we come back. Watch the pass rush come up the middle, Bill, and then all of a sudden the light goes on in the heads of the lineman. Oops, this is a screen.
Screen, yep, and you can see it. And Bean just goes underneath. He actually went around the outside block to be able to pick it up, and he screened the defensive end for Central A&M.
Wachlinski will kick for Hampshire. Beautiful drive. 11 plays, 5:17 off the clock. And now Central A&M will try and counter. Perry Jordan is the deepest of the return men, and he has to field a hot grounder at his own 15-yard line. Jordan trying to freelance now, trying to turn the corner, but runs in to three purple shirts at about the 22-yard line, charge led by Steve Thompson. Let's now take a look at the Central A&M offense after the return of 8 yards on the play. Keep an eye on Luke Tillman. 29 touchdowns this year, over 2,000 yards rushing. And then his friends up front, not extremely big, but Sean Prasoon, 6'1", 230. So you can probably assume they're a right-handed team, right, Bill?
And you're going to run off tackle.
Pickup of about two on the play to start things off on their first offensive series. Joe Parity gets the carry. Let's take a look now at the Hampshire defense. The defensive line is anchored by Andy Olson, number 54. He's 6'3 and 260. The linebackers, as we talked in the top of the program, led by David McCarthy, the leading tackler on the team. And you saw Nick Terry play quarterback. He now flips around, and he's a defensive back in the Whippers defensive set. Second down and 8. Tillman on the reverse. He's cut down in the backfield. Beautiful play. Good job of staying at home. Steve Thompson making the play. Watch the right side of the formation. Even though the blocking goes the other way, Thompson goes straight upfield and does exactly what you're supposed to do.
Right, and of course you've got a little deception there in the backfield, and Hampshire's not fooled by it at all.
Now Mark Helm faces his first passing down of the game. Third down and 7. Helm won't get a chance to tee it up and throw it. He is snowed under by Steve Thompson.
Now, and that's the linebacker that we featured at the beginning. We talked about Thompson McCarthy, and you get a chance to see Steve Thompson right here. He's just firing right in, and they're leaving space open. You'll see, there he comes from the backside, and he doesn't have a chance. And this is what Coach Ramsey was afraid of, the penetration that the Hampshire defense creates.
And now the field position battle comes into it as Helm lines it up to punt at his own 11-yard line, kicks it almost straight up. It will be fielded at the 39-yard line by Wachlinski, and Hampshire has great field position to start their second drive of the game. They are on the Central A&M 39-yard line.
You know, Jim, we talked about it early before the ball game started. We talked about what a great, beautiful day it was. But you know what? When you play on this field, because you have two open ends, it really plays havoc with your punting game, and we saw it right there with Helm. You cannot get the ball up too high because it'll come back in your face.
Yeah, the wind is not extremely brisk. It's blowing right to left as you look at your television screen, but it's enough there to cause a problem. That was a 20-yard punt. First and 10. Siler takes the ball on a small counter play, but nothing doing there. He'll lose 2 yards on the carry. Tackle made by number 21, Luke Tillman.
Ball carrier was number 14, you mentioned it. But it's like a tunnel. It seems to come down in here with a little bit more force. The 15 to 20 miles an hour is what the weatherman says, but he hasn't checked it down here in this field.
Second down, 12 for Hampshire. This time, Terry is looking to throw. His man is covered downfield, and he has all sorts of running room. He takes it down the sideline before being forced out of bounds at the 23-yard line by Tillman.
Jim, that was, in effect, almost an option. If you get a chance to see it here on the replay, the quarterback sprints out, fakes to an inside, comes back out, rolls out, and the corner actually went with the receiver, and Nick Terry just said, hey, this is it. I'm taking it right up.
A gain of 18 yards on the play. Ball is now spotted just inside the 29-yard line. Central A&M has to figure out some kind of a way to stop this Hampshire offense. Terry gave the ball off to Andy Brock, and nothing doing on that play. And as so many times you see in high school football, Bill, the big plays are coming on first and second down, but if you don't finish it off on third down, it really doesn't do you much
good.
Right,
there's the play right there, and you've got Brian Huebner coming in from his defensive end position to make the tackle. And you no sooner said it, they've got to come up with a big play, and Central A&M does it. We've got to stop them on first down, because if you can get 3 or 4 yards on that first down, then it's easy pickings for whoever you're playing.
You see Siler going in motion. And that's where the pass goes, a little too hot to handle. And now third down and 11, upcoming for Hampshire.
Do you notice how much Siler is in the action? I mean, he's running the ball inside, he runs the ball outside. This young man is phenomenal, in my opinion. And this is why a coach can get excited about watching football at this level, because you've got guys who are doing everything, and you don't have specialists coming in who have to hold the ball, have to kick the ball, who have to come on the rush. This is the way you like to see it play.
Big down for Central A&M. They need a stop. Terry wants to go along, goes down over the middle, has a man open, but it's broken up on the post pattern, converging in the end zone. Drew Moore knocking the ball down, also into the play, Wes Temples. He had his man open for a second, but quickly the opening closed. Joe Fitchie was just running a straight post pattern.
And you'll get to see it right here. He's open right now. And Nick Terry waited just a little bit too long, because two converging safeties came in and made the play. Wes Temples, of course, knocking the ball down.
It would be a long field goal attempt, and it's not quite far back enough to punt, so on fourth and 11, Hampshire decides he might as well go for it. Big rush, Terry, it's a screen, it's intercepted, picked off by John Brooks. He has nothing but open area in front of him. John Brooks is going to take it all the way, 75 yards for the touchdown. We are tied at 6-6.
And that is a gift. That was a gift. It was a middle screen. They knew they were coming, and he threw the ball, hoping and anticipating that somebody would be there, and of course, he was not there. We'll get a good example of this right now.
What a turnaround.
You know this is a screen. He's looking for the middle screen, but he throws it up, and John Brooks makes the interception. And boy, I'll tell you what, for a linebacker at 6'2", 203, he motored pretty well. Touchdown.
What an unbelievable play by John Brooks. It's the kind of thing that football players dream about. And it may sound cliche and it may sound trite, but what do you think was going through that young man's head? His team unable to stop Hampshire on defense. He makes a big play, and now they'll go for two to try and take the lead. Helm gave it to Pitt. Now Helm still has it. He hit his man at the goal line. Tillman decides to fall on it. Nick Terry was there in the initial hit. Another look at the touchdown. What a huge, huge play that has us tied up at 6-6.
You know, Hampshire had the right call. There's no question, because all those linemen were coming and with that hot breath, breathing right down on Nick Terry. And John Brooks, have you ever seen anybody that has the football, even if he's slow, seems to run a little bit faster?
You saw that end zone down there.
Oh, I guess.
I've got to get there. What a big play by John Brooks. It totally changes the complexion of this game.
And here's a Central A&M. I mean, it was totally dominated. And Hampshire's run real well in offense and putting the pressure on defense. And now you've got a tie football game.
Very similar to what happened in our 5A semifinal game here last week on Sports Channel between Maine South and Fenwick. Maine South dominating the game. Fenwick comes up with a defensive touchdown, got close, and it was a totally different game. Mark Helm will now kick off. And Wiklinski is back deep to receive. And this kick will get back to McCarthy at the 17-yard line. He takes it straight up the field. He has a seam. Got some pretty good blocking before he was hauled down in the middle of the field by Joe Parody. And also in helping out to make the stop was Darren Wall. And the Whippers have first down. So Hampshire has the ball back, but after the return of 22 yards, they've got to get momentum back in this football game. They were rolling.
Well, and the thing now is you've got, you know,
obviously by the score 6-6, you've got a new football game. But Hampshire has to get the same mentality they had when they came out. They've got to be able to run the ball and run the clock down and get that confidence level back.
Well, another thing they need to do is just do what they were doing. They were chewing up the ground. Nearly a fumble on the play. It turns into no gain. Andy Brock came around the corner, was met by a wall of Raiders led by Brian Huebner and Jim Dial.
And this is a good example of the confidence level coming back, not necessarily for Hampshire, but for Central A&M. And you've got Jim Dial and Brian Huebner coming in to make the tackles. And nothing fires up a football team more, especially when you were being outplayed as badly as they were. They came up with a big play, and now everybody's back in the football game because they know they're even.
Second down, 10. Siler takes the ball, had a little room for a second, but the hole quickly closed up. John Brooks leading the charge.
And there's two plays in a row where Central A&M's defense, which is not a bad defense. I mean, coming into this football game, they were touted as being an offensive football team, and you'll see the defense coming in right now. And John Brooks, the young man who scored a touchdown, comes in and makes a tackle on Bill Siler, who's obviously the workhorse for this football team of Hampshire.
Well, this is exactly what either defense is trying to do the other one, put him into an uncomfortable situation on third and long. And you saw on fourth and long, there was the interception. Terry back to throw. Has good protection, hits his man, has a first down. Going out of bounds to the 42-yard line is Mike Meyer. Luke Tillman making the tackle.
You know, one thing about, and we'll see the replay when we talk about it, Jim. He fakes inside, comes back out, rolls out. First and 10. And then Mike Meyer, the fullback, and most people don't look for fullbacks out in the flat. You know, fullbacks are converted guards anyway, and they have a tough time catching the ball. But Mike Meyer is definitely a good receiver, and it's a great play because linebackers don't look for fullbacks out in the flat.
First and 10 for Hampshire. They have the ball at the Central A&M 43-yard line. They go to the ground game once again, as is their bread and butter. Mike Meyer picking up a few yards before being stopped by Jordan and Huebner. Call it a gain of about four on the play down to the 39.
Jim, what I was going to mention is you've got two football teams, obviously, that they like to run the ball first. Hampshire does mix it up a little bit more than Central A&M. But whenever you have a football team that dominates one area, either pass or run, they usually generally don't do that well defensively in that particular area because they don't practice against it enough.
Second down. Terry rolls out, he wants to throw. He has Siler open. Look at Terry run away from the defensive man and then throw it on the line and make the completion at the 25-yard line to Mike Meyer.
Again, wow.
Watch Terry just run away from his man. Check this out.
He fakes inside and then he comes back outside and he just comes upfield. He just outdistanced the defensive end and now he's looking for the fullback who's in the flat. And once again, you can't see the fullback. He comes up, turns and rolls his shoulders. He was almost over the line. He was just by a hair inside the line of scrimmage, so he was able to throw the ball.
15 on the play, first and 10 again. So Hampshire, in spite of the miscue, has not missed a beat. They're moving the football again. It'll be a gain of about five on the play. Meyer, being the workhorse on this drive, he's made two receptions in addition to the carries he's made. And we have played one quarter of football in this 2A championship game. A big play on defense by Central A&M has them in a 6-6 tie with Hampshire. Hampshire lining up for their 24th offensive play. And if you take a look at some of the numbers after one quarter, Bill, you see the domination that Hampshire has had. But really, Central, it's hard to judge them. They've only had the ball for three plays.
Exactly. But the big factor is you got 75 yards on an interception and 6-6. So they're still hanging in there as far as Central A&M is concerned.
Second down for Hampshire. The handoff goes to Siler, and he has room to run in the Central A&M backfield. He'll take it down to the 11-yard line before being hauled down by Luke Tillman.
You know, it's interesting. On the first drive that Hampshire had, now we're seeing Siler run the ball. Siler was the guy on the first drive. Mike Meyer has been the guy on the second drive. This is the first time that Siler has carried the ball that I can remember on this whole drive.
Mike Meyer with two key receptions on this drive. First and 10, ball just outside the 11. Handoff goes to Meyer. He's the first man through. Met immediately at the line of scrimmage. He fell forward for a couple of yards. Brian Huebner leading the initial charge, and then Joe Parody there as well.
I think that's interesting that they've chosen to feature different people in their attack. One way they scored, and why would you change? But obviously, with five different backs, they have the capability of being able to do that. You know, when you go in motion, even though it's short, you can get tired doing it, especially when you're playing defense as well, Jim.
Second down and eight, the ball is on the nine. Terry is going to be met, but he did pick up a couple of yards, taking it down to about the seven. Huebner making the stop, so here we go again. Another throwing down, it would appear, for Hampshire.
And this is a run all the way, Jim. We'll get an opportunity to watch Nick Terry. This is a quarterback sweep. There was no intent on his part to give the ball to anybody, run an option. He was just running a plain old quarterback sweep.
Let me back up a little bit. Third down coming up from the 7-yard line, and you would think that it has to enter the minds of the Hampshire Rippers. This is two down territory. They can't pick up a first down without getting a touchdown. They'll throw for it. Terry looking in the end zone, has man open, and that was really picked off. And if Wes Temples gets back, he's gone. He had nobody in front of him. Wow, the pass is intended for Andy Brock.
Watch this. Watch Wes Temples, number 15, come in here. And he timed it almost perfectly, except he just couldn't handle the ball. Right now, see how he was right there. He picks it off, he's gone.
And watch this. Andy Brock nearly grabs the carom. Check this out.
There's the ball, and he almost came back and caught it. Interesting. And here we're going to go for a field goal. Now, we couldn't make the extra point. Now we're going for a field goal.
Wilkinski is in to kick. The ball will be spotted at the 15-yard line. And that kick is low, and it's also wide left. So after having the ball for nearly the entire game and running all but three of the offensive plays in this game, Hampshire finds themselves in a 6-6 tie.
And with minus 3 yards rushing, they're still right there. Again, this is a confidence builder. They stopped Hampshire.
The broadcast rights to today's game have been granted to Sports Channel by the Illinois High School Association. Any rebroadcast of this event without the written consent of the IHSA and Sports Channel is strictly prohibited. And remember, a huge day here on Sports Channel. Coming up next, we've got the Blackhawks and the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. And then later tonight, the Bulls take on the Utah Jazz. And then we're back here live on Sports Channel tomorrow for the 5A and 6A title games. So go get the drumstick and get comfortable. First down and 10 from the 20. Helm decides to keep, had a little bit of an opening. He'll pick up a couple of yards. David McCarthy had the play read all the way.
Again, we're hearing McCarthy quite a bit, but you have to remember that you have two McCarthys. You have David McCarthy, and you have Adam McCarthy. So you got the McCarthy boys.
One a sophomore, one a senior. David being the senior. Second down. That play had no chance. The Hampshire Whippers had spotted that thing out. It's going to be third and 10. Let's go down to the field to Dave Southwell.
A couple of quick notes here. Mike Meyer has made two circus catches, kept two big drives alive so far for Hampshire. He came into this game with 17 touchdowns, but only three catches on the season. He's got two receptions today. Dan Cavanaugh showing some wrinkles, getting Meyer out into pass coverages where they can find some mismatches. On the other side of the ball, Moweaqua, the big play, John Brooks. He had two interceptions last week, comes up another big one today. He's got four on the season. He's been the big play man the last 2 weeks on their defense from Moweaqua. Let's go back upstairs, Jim and Bill.
Yeah, that's amazing. As you saw, the third down play was incomplete, and that will force Central A&M to punt. Is the catch that McCarthy made where the ball was way over his head. He had no chance of getting it. Somehow he got a hand. But the thing was, in that play, Bill, he didn't try to catch it. He just tried to get a hand on it, and then he caught the carom. But that's amazing for somebody who caught the ball that infrequently during the year to make a catch like that. It just shows that you're playing both ways, that you're usually a pretty good athlete. On the short hop, Hill picks up the ball, and fair catch called for by Wilkinski. He leaves it on the turf, and it looked like he got it back. Wilkinski will fall on top of the ball, his own 44, and almost another big play for Central A&M. Perry Jordan was right there looking for the free ball. 35-yard punt on the play.
Well, we'll get the opportunity. He's waving right now for the catch. You know, a lot of high school people feel that you have to stay where you are when you're waving. You can move. It's not three steps. You can catch the ball any place as long as you've given that signal and it's been very aware.
Well, I don't know if I could wave and move at the same time myself.
So. No, you got to have. And a lot of kids look at it that way.
First down and 10 from the 43. Hampshire has the ball again. They'll swing it out to Siler. He had no chance. Helm decides, I know what this play is going to be. He filled the hole and made the tackle.
That was identical play to Central A&M. It's a little inside throw inside, and then you try and bring your either wide receiver or your tackle out to block on the outside corner, and Helm read it real well, came up and made the play.
Helm and his team being supported by a huge contingent of Raider fans that stands across the way, jam-packed with Raider faithful. Loss of three on the play, second and 13. Terry is back to throw, has plenty of time, throws it over the middle, nearly picked off, and waiting for the signal from the official. It's a completion. Good job on the play by Wachlinski of making the catch. Luke Tillman almost had the interception. Wachlinski took it away from him.
Yeah, this is almost simultaneous catch by both Tillman and Wachlinski, and he makes the catch, and this is a tough one because he really hit hard, and he holds on to the ball.
Here's the difference in the game so far. Hampshire has been able to throw when they've had to. In third and long situations, Central A&M has not been able to convert. Hampshire on the move once again. Siler is hit behind the line of scrimmage, stayed with it, and will now nudge the ball out to about the 48-yard line. That's going to bring up fourth and two.
Joe Pierce, one of the linebackers, the leading tacklers for Central A&M, in on another play, and he's all over the field defensively. He's really doing a fine job for Central A&M.
Officially, it's fourth and one from the 48-yard line of Central A&M. Wachlinski is back to punt and decides to angle it toward the sideline and gets a great roll. The question is, will the ball go out of bounds?
Oh,
yes, it's out of bounds at the 2-yard line. A great punt by Wachlinski. Just decided to roll it down there, a 46-yard punt, and when Central A&M gets the ball on offense, they're going to be backed up to their own end zone on the 1-yard line. Still tied, 6-6. High school players are used to playing on grass, but Paul Wachlinski has got to like this artificial turf.
Well, the ball bounces and it goes out at the 2-yard line, so you have to like the turf.
A&M backed up to their own goal line, and of course they have to try and run it out of there. Parity made the carry, maybe picked up a couple. Let's take a look at this and watch the way this thing just takes off on the turf.
You know, the other thing, Jim, is when you can dominate teams offensively and defensively, you don't punt that much. And look at this punt. It rolls right out. In fact, I think you're right. I think they got short change. It should have gone out at the one. They gave them the benefit of the doubt and put it at the two.
Second down and seven for Central A&M. They have gone three and out in both of their offensive series. Helm got the pitch away before it was hauled down, and nearly breaking loose is Luke Tillman. He'll take it out to the 18-yard line before Wachlinski pulls him down.
Well, this is the one thing that I have felt before we came into the game, looking at the teams. This offensive play where they roll, he reverses out and tries to make the pitch. The coach, Mark Ramsey, likes to run inside. That's exactly what he wants to do and how he wants to beat you. But in order to beat Hampshire defense, you've got to be able to get outside, and you've got to be able to use the option outside, and there's a good example of it.
First down of the game for Central A&M. Trying to get a little bit of a drive going on offense, not so much to score, but just to get out and maybe get a little advantage in the field position battle as Tillman carries for maybe a yard out to the 19-yard line.
Well, Mark Ramsey likes to run inside the tackles, and he's had success all year long, so you don't like to change. But with a defense where it's predicated where you have eight people on the inside, and there's Coach Ramsey, you have eight people inside, they're taking away that tackle. So you've got to be able to get outside if you're going to be able to beat them.
Second down and nine. 5:11 remaining in the second quarter. Helm is back to throw. Helm is in trouble back at his own 5-yard line. What a great block to get him free, but then Helm runs into more trouble and finally just fires it out of bounds. He was hauled down after all that by Andy Brock, but what a great block. Watch this as Helm turns around near the goal line and heads back upfield.
Now he reverses out, and now he's being pursued hot and heavy, turns around, picks up a block. We've lost it on our screen here, but then he's able to throw the ball out. Here we get.
Watch the bottom of your screen.
Watch this block. Picks up two people, and of course gets rid of the people able to breathe on that quarterback to be able to throw the ball and throw it out of bounds.
Craig Mitchell, the center, with a huge hit. Helm is in trouble again. It's a jailbreak. Gets rid of it and unable to pick up the ball and make the catch. It was number 42, John Brooks, David McCarthy, and they're disrupting things. So that will bring a fourth down from the 19. Central A&M is going to have to punt. Bad news is they don't have very good field position for the punt. The good news is at least they're not punting out of their own end zone.
And if you need to go to bad news again, the last time they punted in a situation like this, they only got a 22-yard punt.
The twin safeties for Hampshire line up at their own, or I should say at the central 45, and the kick will be a little bit better than that. And this could be a huge play because nobody is back to cover the punt. What a great punt. It's going to finally roll dead right about the 26-yard line. Wow, what a way to get out of a hole.
Central A&M has really had quite a few breaks in terms of the score being 6-6, their offense not being able to do the kinds of things that they have been accustomed to coming into the championship ballgame. So it's interesting that they are still in this ballgame. This is the kind of game when you go in at halftime, you say, look, guys, we're not playing very well, but we're still in this football game, and you can sell it on people. You've got to be able to sell that kind of a situation to your team.
It didn't put points on the board, but that 60-yard punt by Mark Helm, easily as important as the interception return for the touchdown by John Brooks. Hampshire dominating every offensive category in this game, especially time of possession. They set up first and 10 on their own 21-yard line. Handoff goes to McCarthy. Check that, the handoff was inside to Andy Brock. He picked up some yardage to about the 29-yard line before he was hauled down by Tillman.
You'll see right here. Now, Tillman's a safety, and Brock just turns up inside on a trap. Look at that hole. You could drive a truck. I think, Jim, you could have run that one.
I think I probably could have.
I don't know.
I would not have picked up as much yardage, though.
I don't know if you would have had to wave your hand, though, but there it is. I'll tell you what, that's a great trap lock.
So now, second down and one, and this time McCarthy gets the call, and he bowls his way out to the 38-yard line, picking up the first down before he was hauled down by Brian Huebner.
You know, if you look at this offense that Hampshire has, it really is predicated on some of the option principles. That's just nothing more than a veer going to the outside shoulder of the tackle, and yes, you've got people in motion, which gives you the illusion that you're doing some different things, but not really. You're playing regular old dive football, going straight ahead at people and blowing them out up front.
Hampshire working on hitting triple digits and rushing already. 3.5 minutes remaining in the second quarter. Terry got rid of the football before the surge came up the middle. McCarthy is going to take the ball just over the 40-yard line.
And Meyer again, the workhorse, picking up a few yards. And he's only about 2 or 3 yards deep in the backfield, and he hits up in there awfully quick to be able to get that yardage. You better be ready on a defensive front if you're going to be able to catch Mike Meyer.
Joe Fitchie will be split wide to the left on second down and 7 from the 40. Terry gives the ball off to Siler. He will take it out to about the 43-yard line. It's going to be third down and long. Tillman making the stop.
You know, you see Luke Tillman being able to come up here and make the play. And you know, when you've got your tailback who runs for 2,000 yards, and he's got to spend that much time defensively, it's tough. That takes a lot out of a running back to have to do that.
2:31 remaining in the second quarter. Game tied up at 6-6. Van Tripp from Arcola, who if you saw the 1A game, was hurt at the end of the first half. He's not seriously hurt. You saw him taken off the field, and it looked like it might be serious. He had a stinger in his shoulder. They took him to the hospital for precautionary measures. That certainly appears to be good news for Van Tripp. And one thing about football is it can be somewhat of a dangerous game. And when people get hurt, they just don't mess around. So many times, thank goodness, it's a lot more serious than it appears. It's just a precautionary measure to stabilize the player.
Well, the thing with those stingers is that you get some numbness down your arm, Jim. And, you know, you always want to make sure of the type of injury. You don't want to make a mistake. And, because of the turf, and that's one of the complaints that a lot of players have, is you get that kind of a feeling. And when we drove up here, we saw the ambulance, and they had the fire department, and I thought maybe the stands were on fire, but obviously they wanted to take care of the young man, and they did it right, and it was good news.
Either that, or we thought that it might be Mike Lederman and Jack McInerney have gotten into it. Anyway, our coverage of the 1995 IHSA Football Championships continues tonight on Sports Channel. 4:30 on Sports Channel Plus for the 3A championship game between Spring Valley Hall and DuCoin. Replayed on Sports Channel 11:30. Then at 7, Bill and I will be back for Providence against Springfield Griffin. Check with your local programming provider about the availability of Sports Channel Plus in your area. Incomplete on third down and long. So Central A&M will once again hold on defense. These guys are unbelievable. They are so resilient. They've only given up 6 points on defense so far. They've scored 6. They've done a great job of hanging in a football game in which they have been dominated so far.
Well, Bill Seiler went out on the side, and he was the only receiver to the left side of the formation. The formation showed strength to the right side, and Seiler snuck out, and they tried to throw him the ball, and obviously it hit him in the hands, and he wasn't able to catch it.
Wachinski will kick to Tillman, and he is going to let it bounce and decides just to leave well enough alone, and the ball will finally roll to us. You touch it when it's rolling backwards, don't you?
You try to.
Oh, they're letting the clock run is what they're doing. So what initially looked like maybe not so brilliant a play, they were letting the clock run down. I guess you figure, hey, we can run 10 or 12 seconds off the clock. We'll give up 3 yards to do that.
Well, with the way they play defense, obviously that's not a concern of theirs, and they have dominated. Obviously you just don't want to give anybody any more yards than they really should have.
Started out as a 27-yard punt, ends up as a 23-yard punt.
The thing with Wachlinski is he does not punt the ball straight ahead. He punts it out to the right.
Under 2 minutes remaining in the second quarter. Helm and his teammates are going to have to move quickly. They want to score. Helm has some room. Helm trying to turn it to the outside. He will lead it across the 40-yard line. He'll pick up a first down on the play. Wachlinski coming up and making the tackle. And Helm did get out of bounds, so the clock stops with 1:44
He just reverses.
Remaining.
He just reverses out. Jim fakes the option. And this is part of an offense I don't think people realize is that Mark Helm has carried the ball 88 times for 463 yards, which is not bad for a quarterback. So obviously he's accustomed to running the ball.
He did not get out of bounds, but he did get the first, and that is why the clock stopped. And the handoff on the counter, nothing doing. Smelled out all the way by David McCarthy and Steve Thompson.
Well, with a penetrating defense like that, you're not going to be able to run inside because when you get that penetration, that just disrupts your whole offense. You've got to run straight ahead against Hampshire. You've got to be able to use the option.
Central A&M will burn a timeout on second and long.
You know, interestingly, we've been rolling here as far as time. You've got two football teams that like to run the ball. But the other thing is we haven't had a penalty yet, Jim.
Exactly. And you can play football games in a big hurry when the games are being as well played as this one is so far. And you get to credit the Central A&M players because Hampshire has done such a great job executing their offense. And one of the reasons why a team like Central is even here in the first place is because they have resiliency, and they know that a football game lasts 48 minutes, and that just because things aren't going your way in a certain spot, don't give up. A big play, as we saw, can get you right back in it, and that's why we are tied up at 6-6.
Well, when you come into this game and you're 13-0, I don't think you have to apologize to anybody.
Exactly.
And this is really, I mean, if I were a coach going into the locker room, you've got 1,000 things that you can point out and say, hey, we haven't been playing well. We're tied. We've got an opportunity, and second half means a whole new football game.
1:24 remaining in the second quarter. Second down and a little more than 10 from the 39-yard line. Helm is going to go back to throw. Once again, he's flushed out of the pocket. He wants to go downfield, threw it behind his man, number 35, Joe Parody. Nick Terry was there on the coverage. And now it's going to be third down and just a piece more than 10. And now you have to wonder if Hampshire is starting to think, well, play a little defense here, get a decent punt return, and maybe we'll have a chance to score before the half is out.
And that certainly would change things around a little bit as far as momentum is concerned.
Very interesting call coming up here. Helm back to throw. Can't find anybody open downfield, now has to try and escape. He was in the motion of throwing. There's a flag down. It is an incomplete pass. No, now they were the officials from the side rule that it was a fumble. The official behind the play was indicating that it was an incomplete pass. Let's see what the call is.
But the flag's down, and generally it's in an area where you have some holding. But let's let the officials make
that call. Let's sort this all out.
We have a loose ball foul on the white clipping.
So that means it indeed was a fumble.
Might be able to see the opportunity here of
Nope, you're going to see the we're going to see the harassment of the quarterback. And there, he actually brought the ball up. And as he brought it up, he was not actually in the art of throwing the ball. He was bringing his hand up. And maybe we get an opportunity a little closer on this replay.
Yeah, that's the exact right call. So now a big break for the Hampshire Whippers. They get the ball on the 39-yard line of Central A&M.
And Andy Brock is the one that recovered the football.
They have 57 seconds to try and put it in the end zone. Hampshire has all three of their timeouts. Terry is going to go back and throw, looking down the sideline. Had his man open for a second. Nearly a great catch by number 42, Adam McCarthy. Wes Temples was there on the coverage.
And he tried to do the same thing. These guys must be good volleyball players.
It runs in that McCarthy family.
Here, look, he bounces the ball up with the hopes that he could come down with it. And Wes Temples was the one that was defending. Ball's bounced up, but he can't come back in and make the play. The ball was out of bounds.
Terry, not a passing quarterback, but he's 7 of 12 for over 73 yards in this game. Second down, 10 from the 39, but the important thing is 43 seconds remaining in the second quarter. Terry is going to roll to the wide side of the field, puts it up in the air, nearly had it picked off. Perry Jordan had his sights on it. He's beside himself that he couldn't come up with the ball. The ball was intended for Hampshire's number 46.
Well, you were mentioning to Nick Terry about not throwing the ball that much. He actually didn't have full range of motion to be able to throw that ball. And Perry Jordan was in on the play. But he's had eight interceptions this year, but he's also had 13 touchdowns. And he's throwing for 1,000 yards. So he is able to throw the ball, but he picks his plays, or maybe Coach Kavanaugh picks how he wants to throw the ball. But obviously he has the ability to throw it. But he does have the ability to throw interceptions as well.
Third down, 37 seconds remaining. Four receivers in the game for Hampshire. Terry is going to go downfield. That thing's up for grabs. And it's caught on the carom! Hampshire scores a touchdown on the carom. Paul Kinski will take it into the end zone.
When have you ever seen a receiver catch a ball in double coverage? He just took the ball and never broke stride. Unbelievable.
39 yards on the touchdown. Drew Moore got his hands on it, batted it up in the air.
Paul Weklinski. What a play.
Wow, we have seen two huge plays in this game, one for each squad. And right now it's a 12-6 lead for Hampshire.
What did we say coming in here that this was great football? We're seeing it at its best right now.
Wachinski will try and add the extra point, but as you saw on the left side of the formation, one of the Raiders came way across the line.
Encroachment on the defense.
And the coach next to me immediately sticks up two fingers and says, well, now that you got it closer, take out the kicker and go for two.
And there goes the kicking team.
So now, let's take another look at the touchdown. This ball was up for grabs. Nick Terry just put it up right into double coverage.
And he was just throwing it up, hoping that somebody would come down with it. And there, make the play. He just comes right through the middle of double coverage and picks it off. And there they go for two, and they get the 2 points.
McCarthy in for a pair. That gives Hampshire a 14-6 lead, a big turnaround in the final minute just before halftime. Hampshire 14 and Central A&M 6.
Go ahead.
The touchdown again, and as you see, two white shirts waiting to pick the ball off, and coming down with it is Wachinski taking it into the end zone for a touchdown. And here's the two-point conversion by McCarthy. This is just good running here.
He just ran right ahead, straight ahead, into the tackle, turned around a little bit to be able to go back into the end zone for the 2 points. What a game. This is really a fun football game to watch and to be able to do.
One thing we also mentioned at the start, Bill, was with two high-quality defensive teams such as this, that big plays oftentimes are the determining factor in the game. We've seen two big plays so far, and each team has had one.
Right, the only classic part of this one was the first drive that Hampshire had where they kept the ball, had 11 plays, ran off 6 minutes on the clock, but the rest of it has been big football plays. And again, you go in at halftime, and certainly if you're Hampshire, you're not going to say, well, listen, guys, we've got it made, we can do this. You've got to come back and be ready to play. And Central A&M, even though they're going to be down 14-6, they're still very much in this football game.
Thank you. Kinski will just roll it along the ground and make one of the up linemen who are not used to handling the football take the thing and fall down on top of it. Ball recovered by Jim Dial. 27 seconds remaining in the first half. The Hampshire scoring drive, 3 plays, 39 yards, and they didn't use a lot of the clock. They didn't have a lot of clock to use, one of the reasons why. And Klinsky with the carom. You mentioned maybe these Hampshire guys are all volleyball players. We've seen tip balls, we've seen them with some really good hands out there. And Central A&M trying to cross things up, doing a pretty good job of it. Jill Seiler coming in to make the stop on the running play. And Central A&M decides to take a timeout with 5 seconds remaining here in the first half. And I would imagine, or do you, load it up and say to Mark Helm, how far can you throw it? Or do you just kneel on it and say, let's get on out of here, because they will get the ball to open up the second half as they defer their choice.
Well, it'll be interesting to see the call, but if you're asking me, why not? Go for it. Line three people up one side, somebody on the other side, and just throw it up and hope.
But you have to make everybody aware that make sure you're looking upfield in case of an interception.
Well, the one guy that's got to do that is the quarterback. Every quarterback, after they throw the ball, should always think that they've got to cover just in case someone's going to intercept the ball. And that's one of the more difficult things to teach young quarterbacks, is to cover after they throw.
And with the formation they're in,
wow.
No way. It does not appear that Helm is going to be heaving the ball anywhere. Well, here's some open running room on the right side of the formation for Luke Tillman. He'll take it out of bounds at the 49-yard line. But time has run out here in the second quarter. A first half of big plays. One for each squad, but it's Hampshire leading Central A&M 14-6 at the end of two quarters. Halftime of our 2A title game, Hampshire leading Central A&M 14-6. Let's check in down on the field with Dave Southwell.
Mark, you've averaged 36 points over the season. Right now, the offense is struggling. 37 yards at halftime. Your big gun here, Tillman, has only got 28 yards. You've only used him 4 times. Are you going to make some revisions at halftime? Are you going to try to get him more involved in the offense? How do you think you can finally dent the Hampshire defense?
Yeah, we're going to try to get him the ball more and maybe try to open up the outside game a little bit. We're not getting much on the inside like usual, so we're going to mix up the pass a little bit more, I think.
As far as defensively, a big breakdown in the secondary led to the other point. Otherwise, you've been bottling them up pretty toughly. Are you going to make any changes there? And it looks like John Brooks has had a real, real big first half. Are you going to still blitz? Are you coming after him?
Well, I think we've been playing pretty solid defense. Like I said, we gave up a couple of big plays that really hurt, but we're going to have to take care of that. But other than that, we just got to move the ball offensively and get some things going there.
Good luck in the second half. Coach Ramsey, let's go back up to Jim.
All right, thanks a lot, Dave. And really, for Central A&M, things didn't go well in that first half, but they're still in the football game, and they really haven't had a chance to get their offense on track. If they could just put together one drive, it totally changes the way this game is going to be played.
Right, when you look at the amount of time that Hampshire has had the ball offensively, and to still be in the football game 14-6, Jim, as a coach, you know that you can talk to your players and say, look, we're capable of playing better. Well, let's go back out and play the way we're capable, and you can win the football game. So at least from a coach's standpoint, I'd be very enthused going into that locker room to be able to talk to them.
And remember as well that A&M deferred their choice, so you would think they would take the ball to open up the second half, and they've got to do the same thing Hampshire did in the opening drive of the game. That is, get a couple of first downs, get some momentum going, and if they can do that, they just haven't really had that chance on offense to really get things cranked up.
And I think they need to exploit going to the outside a little bit, and with the kind of a rush that you're getting in between the tackles, if you can get your tailback and Luke Tillman to be able to cut back, I think you could hurt Hampshire if you're able to do that. As far as the passing game is concerned, I think you got to take it as it comes. Right now, you've got to be able to get your running game in order to be able to try and challenge Hampshire's defense.
14-6, Hampshire leading at the half. Coming up after this timeout, we'll go back to Lance McAllister in the Sports Channel studios. ...14-6 at the half in the 2A championship game, Hampshire leading Central A&M. And Going back to what we talked about at the start of the game, because not that we're geniuses or anything, but as this panned out this way, Bill, is two good defensive teams and the big play has been the most important thing in the game so far.
And of course, John Brooks runs 75 yards for a touchdown and keeps Moweaqua in the game 14-6. And yet you have two tips that were really key plays as far as the offense for Hampshire is concerned.
Let's take a look at the highlights from the opening half of football. Hampshire took the opening kickoff and ground out a long drive. And here is their touchdown play on the drive. It's a running team, but it's a passing play.
Right, and to get there, we haven't seen that highlight. That's Mike Meyer makes a tip and makes a great catch to be able to do this. And they took off 6 minutes of the clock and, of course, 11 plays.
Now, on a 4th and 11 in Central A&M territory, Hampshire goes for it. It's a screen pass, it's a big rush, but here, really, what is the play of the game? And this is why Central A&M is even in it.
Well, and of course, that's a middle screen is always dangerous, and you saw right there why. Here's John Brooks, the defensive lineman, making the interception. And how many times have you seen a defensive lineman run that fast? Anybody with the ball runs awful fast, Jim.
And here's the last big play of the opening half. This is Hampshire with the ball. They're going, trying to pick up some yardage late in the first half to try and get close for a touchdown. They decide to pass, but even though the play isn't exactly executed properly, they get the tip and they get the touchdown.
Well, Nick Terry just threw the ball up hoping, and of course he throws it in a double coverage, and Weklinski just catches the ball in between. It looks like it's a volleyball match.
The offensive stats have been totally dominated by Hampshire. Look at the time of possession, 17.5 to 6.5, but the key thing is the score. Central A&M, they're only down by 7, and once again, they really haven't had a chance to get anything going on offense because they've been behind the entire game.
No, and I would think at halftime that they're going to have to make some adjustments in terms of what they want to do offensively to try and keep the ball away from Hampshire. If nothing else, just run the clock down and be opportunistic as far as defense is concerned.
Bill, we hear so much about second half adjustments, but at this point in the season with quality teams, do you just really go into your guys and say, hey, you guys are 13-0, you're 13-0 for a reason, just go out and execute the
plays? Well, there's some coaches that do well at halftime. A lot of coaches do a lot of hollering at halftime and can't make those adjustments. I would think that Coach Ramsey right now feels that once they get their offense straightened out, they need to go to the outside, they need to run the option, pitch the ball, they need to throw the ball to the outside into the flanks. I would think that they have an opportunity to do well second half.
How key is Mark Helm, the quarterback for Central A&M, to the second half? Because one of the problems that Central A&M has had, they haven't picked up good yardage on first and second down. Then the onus is on Helm to pick up a 3rd and 5, 3rd and 6.
As far as being able to throw the ball. Personally, I would think that you might want to take Mark Helm and use him more as a running back. He has almost close to 500 yards running the football, and I think if you can get your option going a little bit, let him run the ball, and then the pass will be a lot more effective.
Well, we can talk about it all we want, but the proof is in the play, and we'll have the play of the second half coming up in just a bit. 13-6 at the half of the Class 2A title game, Hampshire leading Central A&M. Hampshire just two quarters away from winning a 2A state title. Let's go down to the sidelines to Dave Southwell.
I've got Hampshire coach Dan Cavanaugh with me. Dan, you've won the battle of time possession by mixing up the offense. You've been dictating the tempo of the game. What have you been doing, and what do you see in their defense that you've been able to have success with?
Well, first of all, I don't know how successful we've been. We feel like we wanted to run the ball a little bit more, and we haven't really been able to do that. We've had to go to the pass, and we've been fortunate enough to get that going a little bit. But we want to get our ground game going, untracked a little more in the second half.
Dan, you guys have been involved in 4 close playoff games here. Does that give you a big advantage here, playing in a tight game in the second half to win a state championship?
Well, we've been there before. I'm sure they have too. But yeah, we think that's a little experience. Last 4 games we've been there, so hopefully we can do the same as we've done before.
Let's see if Hampshire can be the team of destiny that they've been all through the playoffs. Let's kick it back upstairs to Jim and Bill. Good luck, Dan.
All right, thank you very much, Dave. Let's expand a little bit on what Coach Cavanaugh was talking about, because some of you may be sitting at home or wherever you might be sitting saying, wait a minute, why do they need to run the ball better? They're running the ball just fine. But they're not running the ball and picking up first downs. Third down, they've had to go to a lot of pass plays. What Coach Cavanaugh obviously wants to see is start grinding out that ground game and keep that clock moving.
Well, what he's talking about is the way they ran the ball at the beginning of the football game. That was their classic style. They mixed in a little pass with the run, but for the most part, they were able to run the football. Now, what he was talking about is we watched in the field house just about 5 minutes ago. They're not talking about adjustments to the kids. They were in the field house actually running through the adjustments of what they wanted to do as far as their running game was concerned.
Don't forget that coming up as soon as we are done here at Hancock Stadium, Blackhawks hockey on Sports Channel, the Blackhawks taking on the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. Paul Kariya has been on a tear of late, and you'll get a chance to watch him and the rest of the Ducks take on the Blackhawks. And here we go now for what may be the key portion of the ball game for Central A&M. You know what amazes me about the crowd here at Hancock Stadium is the amount of different letter jackets you see in the crowd. It's not just students from the schools that are involved in these state championships. It's see jackets from all over the place. A group from Springfield sitting in front of us.
And of course, you've got people here for the next game. It's going to be a long wait in the cold one. If the sun goes down, it's going to be a little bit more chilly out here, Jim.
Central A&M, remember, they deferred their choice to the second half. They decide to take the ball to open up the second half of action.
And I think this is going to be the key to the football game right now as to how Central A&M reacts to what they have to do offensively. And we'll get a real good picture and a real good idea of what their plan is right from the get-go.
Harry Jordan is deep to receive. Wilkinski, who had the touchdown on the tip, is ready to kick off. 14-6, Hampshire has the lead. Squib kick, question will be, will it roll out of bounds? And it does, so the flag goes up. And Wiggles the water boy for Hampshire running out to get the tee.
The flag goes down because the kickoff goes out of bounds.
So now Central A&M will get their first crack on offense. Mark Helm, who really the focus is on him because the ground game has not gotten to the point where it's bringing up third down and three, third down and two. So he has got to have a little better afternoon throwing the football if Central A&M is going to win this football game.
And Coach Ramsey and Mark Helm were just talking about what they wanted to do in this first series of downs. And as I alluded to, I think this is a key right here as to how they react offensively to what Hampshire gives them defensively.
And as they have to go to the ground for the first play. And that's exactly the kind of play that Central A&M did not get the first half. Luke Hillman on first down takes it all the way out to the 43-yard line. That's going to bring up a second down and two. Nick Terry makes the stop. Offense is so much easier when you're working with second down and two.
And they were also going out of an unbalanced line, which they have not shown in the first half.
Parody and Tillman are the running backs. Tillman will get the call again. He will have the first down, taking the ball out to about the 48-yard line. He was brought down by the McCarthys.
And again, out of an unbalanced line with a wing and a slot to the wide side of the field, and then you'll see a trap block right here, and he's inside the trap block. And what they're doing now is they're taking advantage of the aggressiveness of Hampshire's defense, and they're running those little traps inside it. This could be effective.
Central A&M with most of the first half without picking up a first down. They have it already. There's the option that Bill had talked about. Tillman has room. He'll take it around the corner before being driven out of bounds the 44-yard line. So here it comes again. Second down and two.
You know, sometimes coaches are really stubborn. You know, you got here and you're 13-0 and you're saying, we're going to run inside. By golly, we're going to be able to do it. And what he found out in the first half, he could not do it. He had to get to the outside. And everything that we've seen right now, they're getting to the outside. He runs the option. There was no fake there at all. It was just a matter of getting Tillman out in front to be able to pitch the ball to him.
Second down two, all running so far. Tillman is going to have another first down, taking the ball down to the 36-yard line. Another first down for Central A&M.
And Jason Ormond in on the tackle. Now, what's happening is, can Hampshire realize that they're seeing an unbalanced line, and are they shifting their linebackers to compensate so that they can go ahead and make the play?
You get the feeling that the second half is just going to be a contest to see who can run the football and run it the most effectively. 6.9 yards a carry for Tillman in the game. First and 10 from the 36-yard line. Central A&M with their best offensive surge of the game. Tillman gets the call again. Fighting for yardage will maybe get out to the 35-yard line. The hole filled up quickly.
One of the other things we had talked about, Jim, is the ability of Tillman to be able to cut back because you're getting so much pressure and so much penetration. And what's happening is Central A&M now is running to the short side of their field, to the short side of their formation. They're running away from the unbalanced line.
Second down, 9 yards to go on the 35-yard line. Option play again. Helm this time decides to keep. Nice gain down to the 36-yard line. We have got 9:54 remaining in the third quarter of our 2A championship game. Hampshire leading Central A&M 14-6. And for those of you who have tuned in to see the Blackhawks pregame show, we're running a little long right here, so Bill Gardner is going to go back and sharpen his skates and get ready for the game coming up next here on Sports Channel between the Blackhawks and the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim.
Mark Helm is limping a little bit after that last run, and early in the week he had a sore hand, so he might be having some difficulty right here, Jeff.
Third down and five. You would imagine it's two down territory. Tillman isn't going to need two downs. He takes the ball down near the 15-yard line. Ball will be spotted at the 16. It was taken down by Todd Grace.
Mark Helm did not want to run with that football on the option. He did not come down the line. He made his reverse out and pitched the ball immediately. We'll get the opportunity to see it. There it is, and he did it with his right hand, not his left hand, because he was going to his left. Normally, you would pitch the ball with your left hand. He pitched it with his right and pitched it immediately to Tillman.
Not only that, Central A&M is getting up to the line quickly. They've got success going. They want to keep it moving. Tillman on the carry again. He'll pick up two down to the 14-yard line.
Now, you have to keep in mind that if Central A&M were to score, this would only be the second touchdown in the third quarter for Hampshire all season long. Now you have to say, wait a minute, what does that do to a team defensively, mentally?
Tillman is picking up most of that here on this drive. 8:38 remaining in the third quarter. Second down. Tillman loses the pitch. The ball is on the turf. It looked like Tillman got to it back at the 19-yard line, and he did.
Matt Hellman.
See, I knew one of us would do that.
Right. Mark Hellman.
Dean Martin. Not in the
recovery. Right. He just pitched that ball right away. He didn't even wait for the fake, and he just pitched it. And there was no arc on the ball at all. I mean, it was like a forward pass.
Third and 13. The ball is just inside the 20-yard line. Has people all over him, puts it up in the air, and that one will be incomplete. The intended receiver was Mike Root.
I'll tell you, the official that was right there, he let them play a little bit. I mean, he could have thrown that ball, and we'll get an opportunity to take a look at it. He throws the ball up for grabs, and both of them are pushing and shoving each other, and he just let them go ahead and play, which is great. This is a championship game, and as long as it's not flagrant, let them play the game the way it should be played.
Fourth and 13 now.
Adam McCarthy, the defensive back for Hampshire, making that play.
There's been 10 running plays on this drive. 10 of the carries have been by Luke Tillman. But this time, Helm is in a shotgun formation. Looking down the field, he wants Root. The ball is up in the air. Root makes the grab. Touchdown, Central A&M.
Well, we saw two formations that they did not run the first half. That being one, and the other one is the unbalanced line. And Hampshire right now, you're looking at a possibility for 2 points. I would imagine that they would go for 2 points right here.
What a great play by Mike Root. That ball was just laid up in the air for him to go get it, and he did.
And it was a one-man pattern, Jim. Again, here's Helm back to throw the ball.
Helm just puts it out in the area. Now watch Root go and get it.
And he took it away from him.
Great
he took the
play.
Ball away from McCarthy. Root is 6'5" and McCarthy 5'11".
Helm rolls, looking for two. He's going to be swung down by Andy Olson. Central A&M trails, but they have their first offensive touchdown of the game. 14-12, Hampshire still leads. Let's take a break. Hampshire will have the ball when we come back.
How many saves can a Blackhawk goalie make in a game? You make the call by playing Southwest Airlines Great Savers Travel Contest. You can win tickets to see the Hawks take on the Red Wings in Detroit. Watch the Hawks on sports channels to see if your entry is randomly chosen and your guess is closest to the number of Hawks saves that night. If it is, you're a winner. You could qualify for a grand prize of round-trip airfare for two to Detroit on Southwest, the low-fare airline from convenient Midway Airport.
I've got some startling news for you about your life insurance. Many people don't know it, but the premiums for the same coverage can differ widely from company to company, and you could save hundreds, even thousands of dollars by shopping around. Well, there's an organization called Best Quote that will do the shopping for you for free. They compare rates from over 150 of the country's highest-rated insurance companies. They'll send you a free, no-obligation comparison of the five policies that have the best value for you. A 35-year-old non-smoking male can get $250,000 worth of coverage for less than $15 a month. At age 45, it would still be less than $19 a month for that same policy. Call Best Quote now for your free comparison. This is information you should have. And remember, it's free.
Best Quote's 24-hour toll-free number is 1-800-410-4334. That's 1-800-410-4334.
Highlights of the IHSA football playoffs tonight on the report.
We talked about Mark Helm coming up big on third down in this quarter. Well, he didn't come up big on third down. He came up big on fourth down, throwing his first completion of the game on the touchdown play. Now it's a two-point lead for Hampshire. And Helm, who never gets to rest, will kick off. Ball will be taken at the 20-yard line. Wachlinski with a nice return out to the 38-yard line. Let's take another look at the touchdown pass. And remember, this is a fourth down play.
And Helm just airs it out, and it looks like a kind of a lame duck, and the ball's up there. But Root, 6 feet five, you've got a 6-inch difference there between he and Adam McCarthy, the defensive halfback, and he just reached in and made the catch. He pushed off a little bit too. He's been watching the games on TV, but they didn't call it. Root makes the catch.
Well, the referees and the officials have done a wonderful job calling this game because they're leaving it up to the players on the field. Hampshire starts out with a running play on first down. McCarthy will take it up the middle for a couple. Brian Huebner makes the stop. The ball now resting at the 43-yard line.
You know, a lot of times you say, well, this is a key play here, this is a key play. I think this is a key series for the Hampshire Whippers because they have dominated the ball as far as time is concerned, and they need to have another one of those classic drives right here to really take the air out of Central A&M's balloon here.
And the handoff goes to McCarthy. He's the first man through. He'll nudge it over the 45-yard line. So it's going to be third down and a little less than three. Actually, they put the nose of the ball right on the stripe, so it's third and exactly three.
Well, there was a little bit of a mix-up there with Nick Terry. It looked like he wanted to pull the ball, and the fullback kept it. And that's where you can have a real problem with the exchange.
6:27 remaining in the third quarter. Hampshire has the ball. They also have a two-point lead. Terry back to throw. Swings it out. A little long. Incomplete. That will bring up fourth down. Let's go down to the sidelines for Dave Southwell.
I was just talking with Luke Tillman's coach on the sidelines, asking him why he wasn't involved in the offense in the first half. He only had four carries. They said that they didn't change anything in their offensive scheme. They just didn't have enough time to get into the rhythm, but they wanted to get him involved with the option. Tillman's a very bright kid. He's ranked number one in his class. He's leaning towards going to West Point. You can see him running a lot of option next year with the Black Knights.
Well, isn't that the truth? The service academy's all running some form of the option. You need disciplined players to run the option, and the service academies have plenty of them, and certainly Luke Tillman would be a fine addition.
Coach Bob Sutton, that's the head coach at Army, used to be a defensive coordinator, and that's why he likes the option, plus the fact that he can get players to play it. They don't have to have big people. He used to be the defensive coordinator at the University of Illinois back when I was still coaching. I don't want to tell you how long that was.
Ball will rest on the 20-yard line after a 35-yard punt. So here comes Central A&M again. They have the momentum on offense now in the second half, but they do trail by 2 points. Handoff again to Tillman. He has a lot of room. Tillman into the Hampshire secondary. He's brought down at the 30-yard line by Paul Akinski.
They're just going back to the outside, and what they had success earlier, and they're trapping the inside, taking the outside defensive end out, and they're coming up inside. They're still running the tackle, but they're going a little bit wider, and they're actually taking a little bit wider splits in their offensive line to be able to work the ball outside more.
The first downs are now starting to pile up for Central A&M here in the second half. Ball just outside the 30. Option again. Helm with the ball fake. He was corralled by David McCarthy, who had one arm on him and hauled him down. And then by that time, he got a little bit of help from Andy Brock.
In the first half, Hampshire, knowing full well that the pressure would be taken care of inside. Here we're seeing Helm come to the outside, fake the option, turn it up inside. And this is exactly what we talked about, that we felt Central A&M had to do in order to be successful offensively.
You saw that Central A&M is starting to close the gap on first down. They will need another one coming up on the next play if they are to keep that trend going, because that time Tillman lost a yard.
And if Tillman had looked to his right, Jim, he would have been able to cut back and he'd still be running.
Jason Orman coming in and making the tackle on the play. 4:40 remaining here in the third quarter. Hampshire leading by two, third down and six for Central A&M at their own 35. Helm got rid of it to Tillman. He will get close to the first down. It all depends on the spot. From where the official is standing, it looks like he's going to be short by about a foot. But let's see exactly where they put it down the field. And there will be an official's timeout for a measurement. David McCarthy making the stop.
Oh, and did Helm get clocked on that one? He really took a hit on the option. Watch this. You'll see Andy Olson, who's probably the biggest guy on the field at 260. He really took him down. Did he hammer him or what?
That's what you like to see. I think you have a quarterback, go get him.
Well, that's what you tell
him. Try and make him a little shy.
Exactly, that he wants to pitch the ball right away. But in that one, Olson was giving him a message. He was saying, you take that ball, this is going to happen to you more often, pal.
You saw that they were short of making the first down. Tillman averaging now over 5 yards a carry, and as soon as the measurement was made, Helm was looking over the sidelines, hoping that he'll get the lineup under center on this one rather than punting. That's exactly what Central A&M is going to do. Fourth down.
This is a gutsy call because this is real early in the football game.
Remaining in the third quarter. Central A&M has the ball. They trail by two. This is fourth down and about a foot.
Hey, I'll tell you what. They even do it in Moweaqua Assumption. They know exactly what they're doing. It doesn't have to be a big school to be able to make a call like that. They try to draw them off. Now they'll probably go back to punt.
Remember, Blackhawks and the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim coming up next here on Sports Channel. Jim Blaney and Bill Gorley at Hancock Stadium for the 2A championship game. Hampshire leading Central A&M 14-12. The thing I didn't understand about that is Helm looked up like the play clock was about to run out, but there were still 15 seconds left on it. But maybe he just figured, hey, they're not going to bite on it. Well,
after that hit that Olson had, he might not be able to read the clock. You know, you have to take a look at the quarterback, Helm. He plays safety. He's very aggressive. He took a hit like that from Olson. You have to say to yourself, how much finesse can he have with a beating that he's taking, both offensively and defensively?
You know what, I wonder, Bill, if from the angle where Helm is at on the field, if he can only see the back digit of the play clock.
They decided they're going to go for it. They weren't just trying to pull them off.
First down, Central A&M.
Well, did they tell you where they were going? I mean, they put their two backs up as close as they could to make them like guards, and they said, they dared them. You can take a look right here. He reverses out. There's four people at the point of attack, and he just goes over the top to be able to make the first down. That's a gutsy call. You got to like that call. Look at that. Look at that. There's four guys blocking on two to be able to get the back in.
Total yardage is now starting to pile up for Central A&M. Helm keeps, has nowhere to go, makes something out of nothing. We'll take, put the ball on the turn. Fumble is recovered by number 24, Andy Brock for Hampshire hustle after the big fourth down conversion. Hampshire gets the ball back on a turnover.
And he was going to cut back, and if he was able to keep his feet, he had some good yardage. You'll get the opportunity to see it, right? If he comes back where the official is, he makes some big yardage. He fumbles the ball, and David McCarthy was the one that caused the fumble.
David McCarthy just pulled it on out of there. He went for the ball at first. It didn't come out. He kept ripping at it until it came out. Second turnover of the game for Central A&M, and they turn it over in their own side of the field. 3.5 minutes remaining in the third quarter. McCarthy will take the ball right up the middle, and he'll pick up pretty decent yardage on first down. He'll take it down to the 38-yard line. Huebner and Parity making the stop.
You have to take your hat off to Coach Mark Ramsey. He was at midfield, and he said, we're going for it no matter what. This is a championship football game, and I like the call. That's the way, again,
there was
the way
there was a play in Super Bowl 21 between the Broncos and the Giants that was similar to that. Parcells went for a fourth down at midfield and made it, and it turned around the whole football game. The difference was the Giants hung on to the football. Good yardage up the middle for Brock, who recovered the fumble, and he is going to be close to a Hampshire first down.
Just a little inside play, and he stepped up inside. He had to jump over a couple people. He keeps his feet. He gets at least another 10 yards. And Joe Parity, a stalwart on defense for Central A&M. Again, the nose guard in on the play.
Third down and about a football. And guess what they're going to do here? All 11 guys in the screen. First down for Hampshire.
I don't think I can ever remember a football team that is backs that are that close to the line. I mean, they're 1 yard deep, and they just blow in there as fast as they can. You get the opportunity where you can't really see the depth, but those backs are there.
Almost a face mask.
They're right there, yes.
That is just your extreme basic football. We're going to run it. You've got to try and stop us.
Remember, the old watchword in media was quick hitting. That's what we're seeing right now.
First and 10. Terry back to pass. He will be snowed under back at the 46-yard line. Joe Parity and John Brooks making the sack.
Well, there was a stack in there, and they weren't able to block that. Hampshire could not block it. You'll see Parity coming. He's just blowing right in, and Brooks just blowing right in there and coming in to make the tackle on Nick Terry.
And this changes the entire complexion now of the offensive series for Hampshire. 9 yards lost on the sack. That brings up second down 19 from the 44.
As a coach, I'd look for that screen right now because you know that they're going to be coming hard.
Instead, it's a pitch play into the backfield. And picking up a few yards on the play, Adam McCarthy takes it out just to the other side of the 40-yard line. It'll be third down and about 14.
You think they're a little gun-shy at the screen since the last time they threw one, Brooks scored a touchdown.
We have not seen very many carries by Bill Seiler here in the second half. He was one of the meal tickets in the early going of this game, and he has been relatively quiet. Down and a bunch. Terry has plenty of protection, lays it out down the field. A completion down inside the 15-yard line. Hauling it in was Steve Thompson. He was taken down by Tillman, but not before he had taken it deep into Central A&M touchdown. A big conversion for Hampshire.
And Steve Thompson is not somebody that's been in a lot of the pass plays. He broke out. He was about 15 yards. Luke Tillman comes up to make the play, and he's wide open. There's a wide open place. He finds the area, and Wes Temples also comes in to make the play. And that was a well-conceived pass play.
27 yards on the play. First and 10 now at the 12-yard line. 27 seconds remaining in the third quarter. There's Siler with his first carry of the second half. Ball's loose. It's on the turf. The Raiders say they have it. The officials agree. Joe Parity was on the bottom of the stack. Sean Pursoon may have come up with it.
That was Sean. That was definitely caught by Sean Pursoon, the nose guard. Now, Siler's coming in here, and he's a hard runner. Boom. There's the ball.
Right on the ball.
There's the ball right out. And he's trying to make extra yardage, but that helmet was right on the ball, and you can't fault the runner for that.
This guy is, he's trying to get everything he can, and that ball is just up for grabs.
Wes Temple's put his helmet on the ball and popped it free, and now Tillman goes back to work for Central A&M. And that will be the final play of the third quarter in what has become the defensive struggle that we expected between these two defense-dominated teams. When we come back, the fourth quarter, Central A&M trails by two against Hampshire in this 2A championship game. Jim Blaney and Bill Gorley back at Hancock Stadium, one quarter to go. Hampshire leading Central A&M 14-12. Don't forget, coming up next right here on Sports Channel, the Blackhawks take on the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim. A little business to take care of here before we hit the ice with Pat and Dale.
I was going to say, don't hit that clicker yet, because we've got a real fine football game and 12 minutes to go.
Second down, seven. Helm has to keep it, and he'll take it up out to the 19-yard line, where he's taken down by Jason Orman. First down, the chains will move.
He was tackled by number 55, Jason Orman.
And now Central A&M is at that point of the game where if you can grind it out and take it down the field, you may be able to run enough time on the clock, where all you've got to do is play some defense the rest of the way. So the possessions now are even more magnified, because the time you have the ball now may be the last.
Well, the key possession, there's that word again, key.
That time, the fullback, number 35, Joe Parity, getting the tackle. He didn't get much, did get a little. It's going to bring up second down and still 10.
There's some great hitting going on. You can hear it all the way up here, Jim. These kids are really playing hard. They're playing for everything they can possibly play for. And the championship is one thing, that's all set aside. But they're playing this game with all their heart and all their soul, and they're really giving it everything they can.
Second and nine officially. Helm decides to go to the option. He pitches it back to Tillman. Ball is loose on the turf. It is picked up and taken into the end zone for a touchdown by Andy Brock. Nick Terry popped it free, 15 yards, and the fumble return for the touchdown. And Hampshire now has controlled the football game, leading 20-12 with a huge extra point coming up. One of the Hampshire linemen is down on the field.
And is that ironic? Nick Terry comes in to make the play. Now here's the option play. It's just a sprint option. The relationship was not real good, and Nick Terry makes the tackle and just put his hat right on the ball. It went through the arms, and Andy Brock goes in for the touchdown.
So Hampshire has now turned it around. The player down on the field for Hampshire is Andy Olson, the 6'3", 260 senior.
He's the biggest man on the field. And there's Wiggles, the water boy, looking over the scene.
Andy Olson, also on defense, mans the defensive end. So one of the things about having a player get hurt and maybe not being able to continue this game is you don't lose one player, you use two.
Here's a little better perspective, and you can see the poor relationship between the quarterback and the tailback, Tillman. And there's the hit, and the ball just pops right up. And
you're just supposed to fall on that thing, right, Bill?
What, yeah, well,
what
that's what I tell
Andy Brock.
That's what I would tell, and Andy Brock wanted to score. But on the turf, it's a little different, because the ball bounces a little bit better.
You get a little truer bounce, but just a great hand shown by Andy Brock as he takes it in for the touchdown.
I mean, when you and Jack did the game last week, do you think somebody would have picked the ball up like that? They would have been sloshing and going here and there.
They would have had to get the trencher to get the ball out of the mud. And Olson walking off under his own power, but we'll have to find out if he'll be able to continue in the contest. Now, let's get back to the extra point. It's an 8-point lead right now for Hampshire. They can bump it up to a 9-point lead. Wachlinski in to attempt the extra point. He's already missed one. This time the kick is low, and it's no good. So it remains an 8-point lead for Hampshire with 10:39 remaining in the fourth quarter in the 2A championship game. Let's go down to the field. Dave Southwell standing by with a man who has twice as many reasons to be proud. Dave?
This is a man who's got a lot to do with Hampshire's success this year. Orland McCarthy, his sons David and Adam are two of the three leading tacklers. David had a big strip a couple of moments ago, and he's also been instrumental in giving them a big boost. If you can see behind us, we've got a huge balloon. Orland, you sell carbonic gas in Hampshire.
That's correct.
And what gave you the idea to bring this balloon and this down to this game?
Get our message across and support the boys in the game today.
It came out early. The Booster Club helped direct that. It's been the biggest balloon I've ever seen down here at the state finals. And I don't think their balloon is going to pop. Hampshire has all the momentum going right now. And Noel McCarthy, he's going to be up there on top of that balloon by the end of the game, riding it over to stadium. Let's go back upstairs to Jim and Bill.
And time now for his son David to play a little defense. Nearly a big punt or a kickoff return for Perry Jordan. Took the ball out to the 45-yard line on first down. Central A&M staying with the run. They've got plenty of time. 10:15 remaining here in the fourth quarter. And remember, the Blackhawks and the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim coming up next here on Sports Channel.
Tillman carry, gain of 5 yards.
Ball is just over the midfield stripe.
Ball is
second down, five.
That's the way you want to run your offense, is where you can get the 4 or 5 yards on that first down. And then you can kind of dictate offensively what you want to do defense.
It makes life so much easier. Helm wanted to pitch, but what a great defensive play by Andy Brock. He cut off the path for the pitch. Helm had nowhere to go. He goes down for actually now they move the ball back. It's a loss of a couple of feet on the play.
With the way Hampshire plays their defense and the penetration that they get against people in the middle, you almost feel that you'd have to sprint out on your option rather than reverse out, because you're not getting the time to be able to do that.
Third down, Helm on the counter handoff. Hampshire not fooled by that at all. Adam McCarthy makes the stop. Perry Jordan, who had the big kickoff return moments ago, just couldn't get anything moving on that play. That will bring up fourth down and five from just over midfield.
You know, you're getting so much penetration up the middle that when you want to go and run a counter, you've got to go a little closer to the inside, because you're getting a big push in the middle and you can't take and turn it upside the way you'd really like to. So you've got to have that wing back turn it up a little quicker right off the middle pile.
A&M is 2 of 2 on fourth down conversions, but they have to punt the ball away here. Helm with a pretty good kick. It's going to hit and get a good bounce. Well, now it gets a little backspin like one of Bill's wedges and comes back to about the 23-yard line where Jordan downs the football. So now it is time for Central A&M to play a little defense. There's 8:28 remaining in the fourth quarter. Hampshire leads it by 8. They have the ball. So here's a chance for them to go to the ground game. If they can just grind it out and keep it moving, Central A&M may never get the ball back in this game. So that is certainly on the minds of the Raider defense.
And then, of course, if you're looking at it from Central's point of view, what a great place to be able to make a big play, because you're in four down territory inside the 20-yard line, and you're an opportunistic defense, and they've played well all year. Why not do it here?
Handoff goes to the wing back, Andy Brock, who made the touchdown on the fumble recovery just a little while ago. West Temple's making the stop. Don't forget, Hawks and Ducks coming up. Pattondale will have the call. Our game here, 8 minutes now remaining in the fourth quarter. The 2A championship game, Hampshire leading Central A&M 20-12.
And this game has had everything you could ever imagine. It's an exciting game, and you're seeing two teams really play hard.
Second down, and Terry is rolling out. Terry will go downfield, and it's incomplete. The intended receiver, McCarthy, number 46, although the man closest to the football was Steve Thompson. And here's the kind of call, Jack, that I have a hard time, or excuse me, Bill, as I have a hard time understanding, is you just want to keep that clock moving there. Why throw the ball in that situation?
Well, I think it started out where Nick Terry was going to be able to run the football, and then he had receivers in there too. It looked to me like he initially wanted to run the football from a quarterback sweep standpoint, but he also had people out. So he has the option either run the ball or throw it. So again, yes, you want to run the clock down, but you also need to get first down.
The big thing here is the clock is not moving. 7:37 left, third down and 6. Central A&M facing their biggest play in defense of the game, and a missed handoff in the backfield. Terry gets hit behind the line of scrimmage. Jim Dial with the big stop. The Raiders are going to get the ball back.
And you can get the opportunity to see there's a mix-up with the handoff, and wisely Nick Terry just turns around, tucks the ball away, and he runs into the fullback. I mean, they did not have an idea of what Frick was going to do with the ball, and Frack had it, and Nick Terry was wise to hold on.
Punt is on the way. It's a low-line drive, and Luke Tillman doesn't even get a chance to handle it. It bounces out of bounds at the 48-yard line. Central A&M is going to have great field position after the 23-yard punt. 6:59 remaining in the fourth quarter. A&M has the ball. They trail by 8. In the time of possession battle in this game, Hampshire has had the ball for 24 minutes. Well, guess what? If Central A&M can take it down the field and get a touchdown, chances are that thing's going to be dead even by the end of this game. First and 10 from the 48-yard line of Hampshire for the Raiders. Helm waves it up in the air for Root. He almost made the catch, and then it was almost picked off by Leklinski.
Well, there's no question that Central A&M is going for a mismatch. They throw the ball to Root, who's 6 feet five, and there's no way. No one can match with Hampshire.
So decides to go with the pass on first down. The incompletion, of course, brings up second down and 10. But remember, with 6:53 remaining in the game for Central A&M, it may be four downs per.
And why not pound it out? You've got 6 minutes to be able to do that and go in and get the, at least get the tie, or try for the tie anyway.
And on the other hand, you still got three downs to try and pick it up. Room on the corner for number 46.
The ball carrier was number 46, Perry Jordan.
Perry Jordan making a big carry.
That's the first time I think we've seen him carry the ball all day.
Of course, Perry Jordan had a big kickoff return after the touchdown that made it 20-12.
Well, at this point, you know, you've got a lot of time. 6 minutes is a lot of time to be able to run the ball. And I know this has crossed your mind, Jim, but they go down and score and you get two. We got an overtime game here.
Yard and a half to go for the first down. Remember, they'll probably take both plays, and Tillman is going to take it up just out over the 40. They're going to be short the first down by a little more than a yard. Let's see what Central A&M is going to do. You would have to think they're going to go for it.
Well, they did it once before, and I don't know why they would even change. I would think I'd put those backs up real close at the guard tackle gap and run that back right in there just like you did the last time and go over the top.
And remember, they are perfect on fourth down so far in this game.
And there certainly shouldn't be any hesitancy. And now the shadows are coming in, and we've got the lights on. So even though it's a bright day, they've turned the lights on with the shadows.
Fourth down and a yard. 6:09 remaining in the fourth quarter. We have a flag on the play. Might this be an illegal formation? Too much time. Now, this presents a problem because if you punt it away and play a little defense, you may get the ball back with about 3.5 or 4 minutes left. Well, however, if you punt it away, you may never see it again.
The problem with that, and there's just a good shot of the shadows that we're talking about why they turned the lights on, but the problem with that play is it took too long for the coaches to decide what they wanted to do. That was more on the coaches than it was on the players on the field. And, you know, early in the game, you had like 11 minutes that they went for a first down. There'd be no question that they went with the same formation. Obviously, it was going to be the same football play that they went for at midfield early in the game.
They'll go on fourth down and 6 from the 44. Helm looking to throw. Has his man open, Perry Jordan. He's not only open, he has big yardage down the sideline. Forced out of bounds near the 20-yard line. First down for Central A&M. And Jordan was flying down the sideline. A gain of 24 on fourth down. A&M now 3-3.
Amazing. Here's a guy that really wasn't into the scheme of things in the last couple of plays. There's a nice catch by Perry Jordan. He threads the sideline. He's still in bounds. And there he is. He goes out of bounds. What a great play. And about three plays earlier, he runs a good play offensively, rushing the ball as well as catching the ball. So he's into the scheme of their offense.
6 minutes left in the fourth quarter. Big stick in the backfield. There will be a loss in the play. Don't forget, coming up, the Blackhawks against the Mighty Ducks of Anaheim, and we certainly apologize to those of you who are tuning in to see the Blackhawks, and we'll get you out there as soon as this one is decided. No one wants to see the Hawks play more than I do, but we got a little business to take care of here. Hampshire leading Central A&M 20-12. We'll keep you updated on what's going on in Anaheim. You won't miss a thing. We'll put you out there to Pat and Dale as soon as this thing is decided. Second down and about 11. Helm the throw. Root is open, goes up and grabs it. He's down at the 6-yard line. Another first down for Central A&M.
Take a look. Again, it's the height advantage. You've got Root at 6'5", and you got Adam McCarthy. And this situation, this scenario occurred a couple times. And there you see there's no opportunity for Adam McCarthy at 5'11", and he might be even 5'10". Sometimes you fudge on how big your kids are.
First and goal. Tillman has room. He will be cut down short of the goal line. Looked like he got down to about the 2. Lukinski making the stop.
This is like a tale of two halves. You had Hampshire win the first half, and right now it looks like Central A&M is going to win the second half. Then it's a matter of who ends up with the best score.
Well, it's as we talked about earlier in the game, Bill, is that you're 13-0. Don't panic if what you've done all year is not working. Stay with it, execute. That's what Central A&M has done. Second down, 2 to go for a touchdown. Tillman tries the middle of the formation, won't quite get in, although he did pick up a yard. It will be third and goal from the 1.
It's the same formation that they went for first down. They put two backs real close to the line. Tillman obviously can't get up in the air high enough to be able to break the plane to be able to score. So they're short about a yard and a half.
10th play of this drive. 4:03 remaining in the fourth quarter. Tillman takes it down near the goal line.
Not
no signal as of yet. And it will be fourth down. And it looks like it's going to be less than a foot.
It's maybe the length, half a length of the football. They just motioned that. And, what do you go with? Let's take a look right there. There's the same play. They haven't changed anything. Tillman just bangs in there right behind 4 people, and they're going to go with the same exact play.
They'd love to go 4 out of 4 on fourth down. Tillman got in, touchdown Central A&M, but remember, they still trail by 2.
And that's 4 plays, the same football play, and they just kept banging in there. Tillman just kept jumping up. They're bound to get it. Last week, Hampshire stopped PLB on the goal line with a yard to go on a very similar situation. Of course, it was a little muddier than it is here.
The 2-point conversion to come. There is 3:25 remaining here in the fourth quarter. 3 wide on the right side of the formation, and as you might expect,
a timeout
called by the Hampshire defense. They have not seen that formation all game long, and a wise move by the Hampshire defense to make sure they do the right thing. Remember, Blackhawks and Mighty Ducks coming up here on Sports Channel. As soon as we get out of here, Hawks and Ducks are underway in the first. No score in the first period. We'll keep you updated on that game.
Here's a touchdown. Reverse out by Helm, and Tillman just takes it up and turns it over, and boy, it was close.
Wow.
I don't think it, he had it more than maybe by the size of his football helmet over the ball, over the goal line, I should say. That was very close. Wisely, Hampshire, looked at that. They see a triple set to the wide side of the field, and one of them is Root, who's at 6'3". Now, obviously, you're going to try and get him where he's free and able to get in front of one of the shorter defenders for Hampshire.
And remember, it's 3 yards for the 2-point conversion.
I mean, you used Root before in similar situations. Why would you change it?
Well, the time of possession is almost balanced up. 24, and then you add on 3 minutes for Central A&M in that drive, and they're up over 20 now as well. Hampshire leads by 2. 2-point conversion attempt coming for Central A&M. Still the three receivers to the right, but they will go to Root on the left. Jump ball. Flag is down in the corner of the end zone. We'll wait for the call because Root was all over the defensive man, and he is called for pass interference.
Now, that's what they were doing. This is a basketball play here, Jim. They just put three people over there to get that coverage. Interference.
Hell wants an explanation. He'll get one, but he won't be able to change the outcome.
There it is. They just put three people out wide so they've got single coverage on Root. Root actually pushed off. There's no question about it. He did it earlier in the game, and they didn't call it down in the west end or south end of the field, and they didn't call it. This time they did.
All right, let's reset everything for you. 3:25 remaining here in the fourth quarter. Hampshire is about to receive the kickoff, and they lead 20-18. There's still plenty of time for Central A&M if they can make a stop on defense and get the ball back. For Hampshire, it's quite simple. Start making first downs, keep the clock running, get out of here with the state title.
And do what you do best, and that's running those tackles. And don't run any option. Don't run anything that's going to cause you to have a fumble, unless, of course, Central A&M can do that from a defensive point of view. But you certainly don't want to have a high-risk offense running and operating at this point in the game.
Kell would like to get this thing as deep as he possibly can. It's now down to playing defense for Central A&M, and Hampshire can grind it out.
They're going to go for maybe the possibility of an onside kick here, Jim. Yep.
And making a good stop. Number 66, Brian Berry. Ball was kicked right into his chest.
Number 66, Brian Berry made the recovery.
Each team has used one timeout here in the second half. They each have two remaining. Ball will be on the 45-yard line, first and 10.
Now, the Hampshire coaches were down beneath us, and we heard them shouting about the good hands people being able to catch the ball. And when you only have 23 people, you're going to put out the same people you have who were out there before and hope that they have good hands.
If you're wondering about the choice to go for an onside kick, the field position isn't important. You just got to get a stop and try and get the ball back. So you might as well increase your chances by trying to get the ball back. I know a lot of people say, well, why not kick it deep and let them play? Really, it doesn't matter on which position of the field you have the ball. You still need to stop them on the first offensive series, or the time is going to run out. So why not take advantage of an opportunity to get the ball back and go with the onside kick?
Any other thing is you have to remember, again, both these teams are 13-0, and they didn't get here without doing some good things. And Central A&M, even though they felt they had a good running attack, they prided themselves on having a good defense. So the defense should be able to take care of the situation. And it's a good point. Where the ball is right now was not really all that important. It's a matter you got to stop the people, whether you're on the 20-yard line on one end or 20 on the other. You got to stop them. You got to get the ball back.
As soon as we determine our champion, we'll send you out to the pond in Anaheim, where the Blackhawks are taking on the Mighty Ducks. They are early in the first period, no score. And we're glad you're with us for what has been a fantastic high school football game.
Jim, I've been doing these since 1984, and this has to be one of the best games that I have seen in all those years. You really get caught up with how hard these kids are playing, and whoever wins, there's no loser.
Second and 8. Terry is back to throw. He's rolling. He has some room to run. He will be just short of the first down. Brought down by Jim Dial. It's going to bring up third down and about a yard.
Now, this is the same exact play, Jim, that you had asked me why they would do this. You know, he looks like he wants to throw, but I question whether he really would throw the ball. He's looking downfield, and if somebody's wide open, he might. But the big thing is he ran off the clock. It was like a sweep. He got to the outside, and he's been able to get outside all day.
And if he puts the ball up there, he might as well just keep running right on out of the city.
I was going to say, he may not get a ride home on the bus.
Play clock is down to 4. It's third down. And now it is first down. 1:55 remaining in the fourth quarter. Hampshire gets a new set of downs.
And I think all the fans that are below us, the Hampshire fans, felt like they needed to get this first down if they were going to win the football game. And they were really cheering the fact that that Hampshire Whippers got that first down. You know, it's been a long time for them. The last time they won a state championship was 1979 under Ron Ellett. In the 70s, they pretty much owned the 2A. And they have not had a championship team up until now.
1:36 remaining. Central A&M still has two timeouts. Play clock down to three as the ball is snapped. The key thing here now for Hampshire, don't even worry about the yards. Just hang on to the football, and Central A&M will burn one of their timeouts.
Brought down by number 15.
From a defensive standpoint, they've got to play, try and strip the ball, do anything, get that ball to bounce on the turf so you can get the ball back.
Just for the sake of house, the ball rests on the 39-yard line. But the more important numbers, 1:26 remaining in the fourth quarter.
Second down at about six after that gain of four.
And it's second down. Central A&M with one more timeout.
It's interesting.
Check that. They're out of timeouts.
It's interesting. Your picture doesn't show this, but the coach from Kavanaugh is out talking to the offensive team right now with the timeout. Nick Terry, he's doing more finger pointing than the coach about what they needed to do to be able to get the ball and keep the ball.
This reminder when kids from the Moweaqua play their games, they make it official with Route 7.
Nobody is split out wide. McCarthy on the carry. He gets stood up at the line of scrimmage. He just wants to make sure he hangs onto the football and stays in bounds.
Wes Temples and John Brooks make the stop.
Third down will be coming up. The play clock has yet to start. And the play clock starts now, and there will be 43 seconds remaining in the game about the time the ball is snapped.
There will not be any fancy handling of the ball. It'll be a straight handoff and hold on to it with both hands.
The way this is working out is A&M has to stop them on two consecutive plays. They might still get one more shot at it. McCarthy, again, hangs onto the football. It's the prime concern. He's taken down. Fourth down will be coming up.
And there is no timeout for A&M.
And let's see when the play clock gets started. It starts right there. There's a difference of about 8 seconds. Make that 7 seconds in the 2 clocks. So if A&M can make some kind of a stop, if they decide to go for it, they'll get the ball back one more play. But the question now becomes, do you even dare try and punt this thing away if you're Hampshire?
They're running the clock down, all the way down as far
as they
can.
They'll call a timeout.
Right.
8 seconds remaining, they'll call a timeout, and that's should just about do it. They're going to have to snap the ball one more time, so barring something unforeseen,
there's no way that they're going to punt this football.
The only thing that you might have happen on this play is you've got to run out the full 8 seconds.
Well, the play that you questioned a couple times was the quarterback running out. That's the play I'd call it.
Yeah.
Run as far as you can and keep running.
Just make a beeline for the sidelines.
That's exactly right.
And really the ball is pretty close to being in the middle of the field. So with Terry being a right-handed quarterback, you would think you'd want him running to the near side of the field where the ball is away from the defense. So A&M has got a chess game in front of them. They've got to get the ball somehow, some way, if they want to have a chance. They're down by 2, 8 seconds remaining.
Well, there's a picture of Coach Kavanaugh discussing what they're going to do, and Nick Terry, I think, was given his 2 cents. We'll see. It'll be interesting to see if they hand the ball off or if Nick Terry just keeps it and runs it to the sideline.
The big thing A&M wants to do here is who's ever got the ball, get to them in a hurry.
Well, they're all hunkered down pretty close to that line of scrimmage.
They're counting on the officials not. Here we go. Here's Terry with the ball, running away from everybody. The clock didn't start when the ball was snapped, but Terry picks up a first down. It doesn't matter. Terry had turned the corner, and the clock still read 8 seconds. But it doesn't matter because Nick Terry picks up the first down, 3 seconds on the clock. But now Hampshire is one snap away from winning a 2A state championship.
Well, that's what they were discussing. Who who was going to get the ball and how you were going to do it. And there the clock run out, and Hampshire Whippers are the new 2A state championship. There's a replay, and Nick Terry has been able to run and get out to the outside the whole football game, and it didn't change, and at the end he was able to do it and run the clock out.
Thanks for joining us for the 2A title game. Hampshire wins the state championship 2018 over Central A&M. Let's go back to our studio to Lance McAllister.
And the individual awards will be presented to Coach Ramsey and the team captains from state runner-up Central A&M. And now for the trophy presentation. The second place trophy will be presented to the Raiders of Central A&M High School, who finished the season with a final record of 12 wins and one loss. Presenting the second place trophy will be Mr. Bradley. And there it is. Congratulations to the Raiders of Central A&M High School, this year's runner-up in Class 2A. Correction on that record for Central A&M. They finished the season at 13-1. 13-1. And next, ladies and gentlemen, will Principal Lee Gilbert, Coach Dan Cavanaugh, and the captains of state champion Hampshire please join the presenters on the awards platform. And now, prior to the presentation of the state championship medallions and trophies, the Illinois High School Association is again pleased to announce that Hampshire High School is the recipient of a sportsmanship banner for sporting a winning attitude. And now for the presentation of the medallions and the team trophy. A special medallion will be presented to Principal Lee Gilbert, and the individual awards will be presented to Coach Cavanaugh and his team captains. And now, ladies and gentlemen, this year's state championship Class 2A team trophy will be presented to the Whippers of Hampshire High School, who finished the season with a final record of 14-0. Presenting that championship trophy was Mr. Wright, and congratulations to the Whippers of Hampshire High School, this year's state champion in Class 2A.
So Hampshire collects the hardware. They are the 2A state champions. We'll close it out after this timeout. The Hampshire Whippers, they are the state champions. Let's go down to the field to Dave Southwell.
We got Dan Cavanaugh, the architect of a championship team. Dan's been here for 7 years. The first four were losing seasons. You got five victories last year. You finally made the playoffs, and then this year, over the hump, an undefeated season. What was the key to bringing this team back to the prominence and winning your first state title since 79?
The key is those 23 guys out there on the field right now. I can't say enough about that group of guys. They're the key. The heart that they've shown, the dedication they've shown for years in our program, it's all come back from tonight. And I'm so happy for them because they've so put in so much work.
Dan, last week you guys were 6 inches from being eliminated. you held on a third down conversion with a 1-point lead, 6 inches from the goal line. Did you believe right then and there that you had the team of destiny, that you were going to win the state title?
Well, I'd be lying if I didn't say there's some doubts in my mind at some times, but I know that these guys never quit. They've been down before, and they never quit, and they sure didn't again today, and I guess I expect that from them.
Dan, congratulations on a state championship in Class 2A. Let's toss it back up to the booth to Jim and Bill.
Hi, Mom and Dad.
All right, thanks a lot, Dave. And Hampshire wins the state title, and Central A&M comes in second, but let's talk about what both teams achieved in this game, and that is the fact that both of them, at times, were very close to getting run out of the football game. To me, the thing that was impressive about this game and about these two teams, the resiliency and the determination of both these schools.
Well, it was a tale of two halves. Hampshire wins the first half, and Central A&M really won the second half, but the score turned out to be 20-18. And, you know, you have to hand it to Central. They came out and did make some adjustments. They changed their running game to go to the outside, as we had talked about, and that really had an effect. And Hampshire had to adjust to an unbalanced line, which I thought was very key for them to do the job defensively.
So the Hampshire Whippers will head north from here with a state championship trophy. They are the Class 2A champions for 1995. Don't forget, we've got more high school football action coming up on Sports Channel Plus. The Class 3A championship game coming up between Spring Valley Hall and DuCoyne. The replay coming up on Sports Channel at 11:30. Then at 7 o'clock on Sports Channel Plus, the 4A title game. Providence against Springfield Sacred Heart Griffin. The replay coming up Saturday morning at 1:30 a.m. on Sports Channel. Once again, our final score, Hampshire 20, Central A&M 18. For Bill Gorley, I'm Jim Blaney saying goodbye for now. The proceeding has been an exclusive presentation of Sports Channel.